thank you, everyone. Good morning from New York. I'm Ramu Damodaran with the United Nations Academic Impact. Thank you for joining us for this conversation on Rethinking Gender as part of our series of conversations, 75 Minutes for 75, on the 75th anniversary of the United Nations. We have a stellar panel with us today, and we are extremely grateful to all of them for joining us. And to begin, as we settle in, it's my privilege to invite Grammy-nominated singer-songwriter Beth Nielsen-Chapman, a good friend of the United Nations Academic Impact. She's been with us for the International Day of Peace. She's been with us for the International Day of Human Spaceflight, which not all of you may have heard about. It's on the 12th of April every year. And she's recorded more than 13 albums and had a number of hit singles. So we asked Beth to choose from her vast repertoire a song that resonates with the theme we're discussing today, and I'm sure she'll surprise us. So Beth, over to you.
Well, this is a song that I wrote many, many years ago. And it's about just the equality of all people in every realm of humanity. It's called Dancer to the Drum. Fast asleep in the dawn of ages, the soul of every child has waited to be born a stranger underneath the drum of his mother's heart. Lying deep in a dream of darkness where fear has never gone. Each spark of a star is life, blind and pure to the world we come. Blind and pure to the world we come. Each of us a dancer to the drum. Each of us a dancer to the drum. Blind and pure we come. One is born to a life of hunger. One will be a king or a rich man's son. One will kill out of greed or anger. One will give her life for another one. There are lies in the smiles of innocence, and there are blooms in the walls of stone. And we will see ourselves in the eyes of everyone we have ever known. Everyone we have ever known. And the heart. Each of us a dancer to the drum. Blind and pure we come. Fast asleep in the dawn of ages, the soul of every child has waited to be born a stranger. Born a dancer to the drum.
All the way from Nashville, Beth Nielsen-Chapman. Thank you so much, Beth, and please accept this virtual applause from all of us. Thank you, Beth. You describe yourself as a creativity midwife, passionate about allowing everyone to blossom the elements of creativity within themselves that are latent. And your song was also, in a sense, related to what midwives do when he spoke about the soul of every child has waited to be born, a stranger, underneath the drum of her mother's heart.
Yeah.
So thank you for setting our tone for our conversation today, Rethinking Gender. Actually, today, the 19th of June, quite extraordinarily coalesced a number of anniversaries. For many of us in the United States, it's familiar as the day known as Juneteenth, the day in 1865, June the 19th, when the last of the slaves in the state of Texas was told they were no longer slaves and were free. It's also the day, June the 19th, when the very first World Conference on Women began in Mexico City in 1975. And it's also the International Day for the Elimination of Sexual Violence in Conflict. And that really brings us to the whole question of gender as an entity, and not just one particular gender, because as Antonio Guterres, our Secretary General, reminded us, sexual violence in conflict is a brutal crime, and women and girls make up a majority of those who are brutalized, but men and boys are victims as well. Now, another birth took place just over 10 years ago in July 2010, and that was the UN entity known to all of us colloquially as UN Women. The first time that the United Nations pooled its enormous resources in terms of human beings, in terms of budgets, in terms of mandates, into one coherent entity working for the women of the world. And we're privileged to have with us today the current executive director of UN Women, Ms. Phumzile Mlambo-Ngika, from South Africa, where she was deputy president, and who will share with us her perspectives of how we can, in the 75th anniversary year of the United Nations, rethink gender from the perspective of what UN Women has seen and what UN Women will hope to see. Madam Executive Director, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Fellow panelists, ladies and gentlemen, glad to be here today. And I hope you and your loved ones are well. Today, indeed, is a very special and a historic day. So Juneteenth 2020 exposes us to how far we have come, but also how far we still have to go. And it is therefore important to have conversations such as the one we are having. For women and girls, and based on our experiences as UN Women, is really the best thing next to a silver bullet. It is not a panacea, but it is an important public good that girls can possess. It enables a child to have a chance to excel and to fight against inequality. Because with education, once acquired, it can never be taken away from you. And that makes it a very, very critical public good, especially for those children and women who are born in very poverty-stricken circumstances. For the last two decades, since Beijing, girls. That conference that was able to bring to the women of the world very important rights. It was a turning point for women, and education was very high on the agenda. And since then, many countries have made strides, not perfect, but indeed we made progress. Because of COVID, the gains that we made in education are under threat. Education is important for ending child marriage. Education is important to fight the trafficking of girls. Education is important for making sure that girls are saved from disease that infects them when they are out of schools and by themselves in communities. And COVID almost recreates those conditions that make girls vulnerable. Gender-based violence is high. Parents think that it's cheaper to marry a girl during COVID, so you might as well get over and done with. Trafficking has intensified in this time. It is therefore important for all of us to pay attention in our response to COVID to fight for women and girls. We need to also address the unequal access to technology that COVID has exposed us to. We already had a gender gap in access to technology, and we now have a bigger challenge in that those children who have no access to technology are truly being left behind. And we need to make sure that we have a pipeline for higher education. And in higher education itself, we need to try and make sure that we retain the presence of girls and boys so that they can complete in higher numbers. And therefore, blended education, where they are able to use online learning as well as in-person learning. It is not going to be possible for most countries to provide the campus experience that many of us might have gone through throughout their university education. There is a need to balance that experience of being in a campus, but also augment that with online education that is open source and gives access to master teachers and master classes. We therefore are saying building back better after COVID must mean that we address these issues once and for all, because the world will not have in a short time the number of teachers that we need in order to make sure that we leave no girl or woman behind and we leave no child behind for that matter. And I hope that our deliberations will give us some ideas of how we could make sure that this time, the next 10 years, as we complete the decade leading up to 2030, we have made education a public good that is universally accessible to all children, irrespective of their gender and location. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Madam Executive Director. And thank you for relating it to the very strange and straitened times that we are in today. If I may be allowed to quote from a distinguished countryman of yours, Archbishop Desmond Tutu, who once said, "God sat down and created man. And then she realized she could do better and created woman." So that's really a thought for us today. You also began with a reference to Juneteenth, and I wanted to share with you a poem that Maya Angelou, the great American poet, had written, where she said, "History, despite its wrenching pain, cannot be unlived, but if faced with courage, need not be lived again." And I think that's really what the message that you convey to us, that we, in our 75 years at the United Nations, have lived pain. We can't unlive it, especially for the vast majority of women in the world, but we can make sure it is not relived. In fact, I mentioned the Mexico conference, and the very first article of the declaration at that conference says that while the problems of women are those of their gender, they are ultimately the problems of society as a whole. And I think you brought that in by your references to men and boys, and we're grateful. So Let's stay with Mexico for a while, and it's my privilege to welcome a very old personal friend, old in a chronological sense of how long we've known each other and not any aspersion upon his youth and agility, Fernando Leon Garcia, who looks after the entire CETUS university system in Mexico. Actually, in the year 1975, when the Mexico conference took place, Fernando had just begun his work at CETUS at a slightly lower level. You, Madam Executive Director, were, I gather, a student at the University of Lesotho at that time.
Yeah.
And Beth told me that she had just finished school and was about to go to college when she decided to join a band and forgot about college. So, you know, we have our various perspectives with education there. But Fernando, apart from being the looking after the CETUS system in Mexico, was also chancellor of the City of Seattle's University before that. And I know he's going to bring in perspectives, including in his current role as the president-elect of the International Association of University Presidents. Fernando, welcome.
So thank you, Ramu, and thank you for this opportunity. I think I want to extend my congratulations for all the causes, all the organizations that celebrate an anniversary today. My remarks, I will try to draw from some data and some findings and recommendations of different sources. I'll make special reference to Latin America and Mexico, but I'll compare in the process to what is going on elsewhere. I'll restrict my remarks mostly to higher education. And the references are from YESALC, UNESCO, Times Higher Education, World Economic Forum, FIMPES, and others. So I think that, first of all, with respect to the Latin American context, 75% of possible men, of all men that could be in the workforce, 75% are in the workforce. Of all possible women, only 50%. So you can see automatically that there's improvement there. And another point of reference that I think is measured extensively is what is the wage gap? And so in terms of the difference between men and women in Latin America, it's about 24%. Okay. Now, moving on to higher education, I think one important indicator is what progress have we made in terms of senior leadership? And here what we can see is that there was a study recently published of public universities in Latin America. There's slight difference, but in the study, it encompassed all 500 universities, 9 different. And the finding was that roughly 18% of the university presidents were women. There are very distinctive exceptions that are worth pointing out. And I guess finding out a little bit more what they're doing, because apparently they're doing it right. In the case of Panama, 46% of all senior leaders were women. And in the case of Venezuela, who is having a tough time, but nevertheless, about 1/3 of the senior leaders are women. More recently, Times Higher Education, around March, they put out an article that related to senior leadership. And their point of reference were the top 200 institutions from the perspective of ranking. And there, 19.5%, not a lot more than 18, were women. So even in the more developed countries, you find that there is room for progress. If you look at other settings, we have the case of the US, and the most recent extensive study was the one carried out by the American Council on Education, where about 30% are women as such. In the case of professoriate, 46% of Latin American faculty are women. So slightly less than 50, but you know, a good number. In the case of the student body, 55% are women. So there's been a good headway made there. If you look at what are the some of the factors that lead to women assuming senior leadership position? The most extensive study, again, was in the case of the U.S. I hope I'm not overlapping with what Don Betts will be covering later. So my apologies beforehand, Don. But in the case of the ACE study, what it found is that women are more likely to assume a senior leadership position if they have had an interim appointment, an interim presidency, or vice presidency for that matter, if they have earned advanced degrees, and if they have participated actively in leadership development initiatives. Now, let me move on to Mexico, where the World Economic Forum indicates in the most recent report available that it was ranked number 66 in terms of 144 countries surveyed. So it's right in the middle, but with lots of areas of opportunity. And again, if we zero in terms of senior leadership, what we find is that on the one hand, we have the data of mostly public institutions, that's ANUIES. And in the case of that study, 11.1% of the senior leaders were women. Margin for improvement, because remember, we've talked of 18 and 19% in the case of all of Latin America or the top 200. In the case of private universities, though, it's 19.3%. That one was data carried out by FIMPES, the Mexican Federation of Private Universities. So, in fact, private universities in Mexico appear to resemble what you find in terms of the top 200 in the world. Let me reflect just a little bit in terms of what has been happening at CETES, which is where we have a greater influence and decision-making power, if you will. And there, what I share with you is that in terms of senior administration, not including the presidency, we have 64% of the positions occupied by women. In terms of deans of different schools, we have three campuses, 73% are women. In the case of full-time professors, 53% of the full-time professors are women. That's above the Latin American average. In the case of students, there's 51%, slightly below the Latin American average. But there are other indicators also. In the case of CETES, and I'll go to what university presidents should be espousing, we have a leadership development program whereby the last 10 years we've been identifying potential leaders and subjecting them to an experience on leadership development. 40% of those that we have promoted to go into that program and then assume leadership positions have engaged in that development program. Now, there's a lot that you can do with what you have, but there's a lot more than you can do with what is coming down the pipeline. And in that sense, what I would point out is that two other data points or data sets that I'd like to refer to is, number one, in terms of the most recent graduation ceremony, those graduating with honors, over two-thirds were women. They're performing exceptionally well. As university presidents, I think that there are very specific things that we can promote in terms of moving the agenda forward. Number one, make it a priority. Number two, set and assess goals and targets. Number three, establish policies that facilitate that. Number four, encourage, promote, and support professional talent and leadership development. Create awareness and espouse the benefits among peers and decision makers. Support job and professional career flexibility. Seek greater transparency in professional pathways and salary structures. Promote work-life balance. Engage in formal mentoring, very important, to identify and groom future women leaders. And support and advance women to positions of increasing levels of responsibilities. So with that, I conclude my remarks. My apologies for the technical glitch. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Fernando. And thank you for that summation, which you brought as both as president of CETES and, as I mentioned, the incoming president of IUP, the benchmarks in terms of priorities, goals, professional coaching, and, as you said, most vital, mentoring to be able to attain the level of gender equity and indeed gender fairness that higher education must aim for. Most grateful for that, and thank you for having joined us this morning. I'd now like to invite Clarice, whom all of you I hope know and will be meeting later in this program, to introduce the UN75 element of our of our conversation this morning and a survey that we have, which we hope that you'll join in. So, Denise?
Hi, good morning, everyone, or afternoon or evening, depending on where in the world you are. Thank you so much for joining us. And as Ramu mentioned, one of our goals in holding these dialogues and in discussing these issues is to talk about some of the most pressing issues that face our world today, and also to hear your voices on how we can address those issues and what those issues are. And so one way that we're gathering this information is through the UN75 survey. My colleague Brenda has put the link in the chat. And so if you could just take a few moments to click on that link, there are five quick questions that we are asking people around the world to contribute their view and their voices on this, because we would really like to hear, you know, what you have to say on these issues. So if you can see that the survey is available, if you click on the link, is available in almost 60 different languages. And you can take it in the language that you feel most comfortable in. And there are just a few quick questions about what you think are the most pressing issues for the UN to consider, the most pressing issues that we're facing in the world today. It's very quick to take. We would love to get your input. The responses will be collated and will be shared by the Secretary General at the 75th UN General Assembly this fall. So it's really important that we hear from you, and just takes a few minutes to complete. So as you can see, we ask what the international community should prioritize better to recover from the pandemic, what you would like to see in the world in 25 years, what three things are most important to you, which of these global trends do you think will most affect our future? And you can select up to three. And how important is it that we have international and global cooperation on these issues? Whether COVID-19 has changed your views on international cooperation between countries? And do you think in another 25 years we will be better off or worse off or the same as we are today? And then whatever other ideas that you have that you'd like to share with us. So please feel free to quickly take that survey, and we would love to hear from you. Thanks so much. So I'll give you a few moments to access that and to share that. But in the meantime, I would like to warmly welcome our next panelist, Dr. André-Thérèse Assi-Lumumba. Dr. Assi-Lumumba is a professor at Cornell University who has decades of experience in comparative and international education. She's the former director of the Cornell Program on Gender and Global Change, and she serves as the president of the Scientific Advisory Committee of the Intergovernmental Program for the Management of Social Transformations at UNESCO.
Thank you so much, and I'm pleased to be able to join you. I took a little while to get to the technical process. Well, I'm glad to be invited to contribute. Of course, in the case of Africa, we're dealing with a continent, it's not a country, 54 national realities, and within each country you have other complexities. So I don't want to appear to homogenize the African continent. However, there are certain patterns that can be observed, that have been observed from the time of independence process a little more than 60 years ago to the present. And those patterns are that there's a gender disparity. Actually, often when you say gender, people think you're talking about women, but that's not what it is, as we know. Gender means more than the statistical representation of men or women or one gender in the education system. The broad pattern that I would like to quickly mention is that We have a Southern African, what we can we call the Southern African reality, where you have a higher representation of the female population in the education system, with the extreme case of Lesotho, where more than about 3/4 of the higher education students are females. And we see the same pattern emerging in a few other countries or sub-regions of countries, such as southeastern Nigeria. However, what is the striking but not so surprising case is, even in those cases where you have a higher representation of the women in the education system, it is not reflected in the discipline, the way the disciplines are organized, the access by the male and female students to the different disciplines, and how those disciplines are valued in society. So if it is the case in those countries, sub-regions, where there's a higher representation of the female population, you can then imagine where there is a still a very striking underrepresentation of the female population in the higher education system. Well, it starts early. As I have often argued, if you do not look at what is happening at the basic level, even elementary school or preschool level, in terms of the gender distribution, and don't look for those who are underrepresented at that low level, don't look for them at the higher education level. Because the preschool, elementary school, secondary school, they serve as feeders of the higher education level. In addition, in some systems, such as the French, those of the French tradition, the discipline you enter at the higher education level is very much determined at the secondary level, as they have all these tracks, the tracks by discipline. So this is the overall situation in the African country. By and large, there is an underrepresentation of the female population in the education system, and the underrepresentation becomes even more striking as you move up in the education system from the lower to the upper level. In addition, one phenomenon I have analyzed and that I'm still working on is what I have called the disciplinary clusters. So when you analyze by gender, you see an underrepresentation more systematically of the gender of the female population in some specific discipline. The troubling problem is that many African countries in the past 10 years or so, in their effort to emerge economically on the global scale, they have given a lot of importance to the STEM disciplines, for instance. And yet, when you analyze the distribution by gender, there is a consistent underrepresentation of the female population in those disciplines. The disciplines that the different governments across the continent think will be the most determinant in positioning African countries. I heard my colleague from talking about the Mexican case. In one analysis that I did, one study that I did, when you compare the private institution to the high public institution, there's a striking representation of the female population. There are more and more female students who enter the private institution. However, unlike here, for instance, in the United States, where I am, although I'm also affiliated with other African institutions, I have a position at the University of Felix Oswet-Boigny and also at the University of Johannesburg as a distinguished visiting professor. So unlike in the case of the US, where you have those private institutions that are very prestigious, in most of the African countries, many new private institutions are money-making institutions that do not invest necessarily in the field that are considered to be the most critical in the future of African development, the STEM fields, because it requires a lot of money to invest in the machines, in hiring the staff, the professors, the researchers. So they tend to avoid those disciplines that require the heavy investment. So it's only the government in most countries that are investing in the STEM field. And this is exactly where you continue to see the underrepresentation of the female population. So when you project the future, you see the a reproduction of the current inequality, the type of institutions of higher learning, the representation or underrepresentation of male and female students in those different types of disciplines. And from the analysis of the representation in those type of institution, it's easy to project where women will be on the occupational ladder within 5-10 years when they graduate from those institutions. So there must be a renewed commitment, particularly in this time of the coronavirus COVID-19, where there will be more urgent needs as expressed by the policymakers to invest in those fields of science, biology, medicine and its subfields. So if we do not have a proper policy in place, there will be that reproduction of female underrepresentation in those particular fields. It's not that I agree entirely with the fact that we need to develop those fields. We need to value more the other fields as well. Social sciences, humanities, they all have a role to play in the future development of Africa. And therefore, those disciplines need to be considered properly as well. However, the point I'm making is that the disciplines that are the most valued in terms of the planning for future development of Africa, those disciplines see consistently or reproduce gender inequality with the female underrepresentations. So these are some of the issues. I could say more, but I suppose that my 5 minutes are up. And I don't know if you hear me.
Yes, Dr. Lumumba, we thank you so much for your intervention. I think the points that you made about the value that society places on some of these disciplines, particularly ones that where women and girls are well represented or overrepresented, raises an interesting question about how do we change societal views of these types of fields and these types of courses of study, because they are also important. And so how do we develop that and change those attitudes in addition to increasing the representation of women in STEM fields? But, you know, how do we change these attitudes about what is valuable and what type of knowledge and what disciplines are worth investing in? I just want to let our participants know that we will be taking your questions. So if you have questions, you can feel free to put them in the chat box. And we will have a few moments after our next two panelists to get to some of your questions. So please think about what you'd like to ask our distinguished guests and put your questions in the chat box. Now I'd like to move on to our next panelist, Dr. Mami Katsumi. Dr. Katsumi is an education administrator in the Division of Institutional Strategies
at Nagaoka University of Technology in Japan. Nagaoka University of Technology is the UNAI SDG hub for SDG 9 in industry, innovation, and infrastructure, and is really a leading university for these fields and also for increasing gender representation in STEM fields. And they have a large international student body and really are training engineers, mathematicians, scientists, technologists from around the world for the future that we'd like to see. So I'd like to now invite Dr. Katsumi to take the floor.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, Dr. Katsumi, yes, hello. We can see you and hear you. Yes, it's very late your time. Thank you for joining us.
Yes, now almost late. Okay, thank you very much for giving a great opportunity to talk today, today's special day. And then congratulations to the UN75. Okay, I'm Mami Katsumi. I'm a university education administrator of Nagaoka University of Technology, Japan. I'm very glad that we could share the information, knowledge, current situation, and good practice regarding gender equality. Today's my talk is divided into three parts. First part is the current situation in Japan, and the second part is the introduction of Nagaoka University of Technology and activities related to SDGs, including gender equality. And the last one is my personal opinion. Okay, first, current situation in Japan. According to the Sustainable Development Report 2019 provided by SDSN, ranking of transformation to achieve the SDGs, Japan ranked 15th out of 162 countries. However, it seems that it is very difficult to achieve the goal of SDG 5. SDG 5 is related to the goal of gender equality. And Global Gender Report, a gap report, 2020, provided by World Economic Forum, Japan ranked 121st out of 153 countries. Still, we have a huge gap among gender. After World 1950, men and women had been working equally. However, in the high economic growth period, our lifestyle was changed. Men work outside and women become housewives to take care of children and wife. Women must be a good wife and then wise mother. Fortunately, awareness of division of labor by gender law is currently changing toward a society in which all women shine. Japan will strongly promote and enhance cooperation with the international community and its assistance to developing countries for women's empowerment and gender equality. Okay, move to the second part. Nagaoka University of Technology is an engineering school, and we are cultivating practical engineers who can be a leader and has the SDG mind. Utilizing global networks such as research and education and industry and academia collaboration. 80% of our students are transferred from COSIN. COSIN is College of Technology, and this is not vocational college, more practical and more professional. It seems as if our university is integrated 9 years education system, from high school, 15 years to master program. We have been accepting international students actively, more than 100 institutions from around 30 countries. We establish 12 offices in 9 countries to promote companies' globalization. And 12 coordinators have a lot of knowledge and support, faculty, staff, and also students, and also local companies. I think today my colleagues attend this dialogue, and then all of us are trying to contribute to the SDGs. And then we were appointed one of the SDGs Hub University by United Nations Academic Impact. We have SDG 9. And in addition, we establish office for SDG promotion. I'm a member of a promotion office for SDG promotion. And also we establish UNESCO chair, sustainable engineering education program. And we promote Gigaku SDG network program in the framework of UNITWIN. And this Gigaku SDG network is composed of 10 institutions in 6 countries. We have unique engineering system and engineering plus SDGs. And to disseminate SDGs, we are utilizing the social media. We collaborate with Nikkan Kogyo Shimbun, a newspaper company. It is one of the founding members of SDG Media Compact. Okay, regarding the gender equality, according to the OECD Education at a Glance 2019, the number of women who specialize in science and engineering is not many in Japan. This is gender gap. To increase the number of women researchers, we took action. Number one, we established a committee for the promotion of the gender equality and provide the good environments to demonstrate their ability for various kind of people. Number two, we applied a program initiative for the implementation for the diversity and research environment. And we got a fund from Japanese government to support female researchers. Number three, this is a very unique idea. We implement own project to be called Kawarika. Kawa is kawaii, cute, and Rika means a science, to increase the number of girls who interested in science and technology. And number four, we plan a whole event and a seminar related to SDGs. And for example, a round table talk with the president and then women researchers and staff members. Okay, conclusion, my personal view and impression. Why we feel that there is less gender equality in the world? Yes, we have biological differences. Only women can have baby. However, everybody can be a mother. Gender, race, and poor religion, it doesn't matter. Individual is very, very important. And then I think it is very important thing is education. We must provide proper education and current information to all. If people receive the proper education, people can think proper things. So then the gender gap, I think it will be disappeared. Okay, at the end, I'd like to give a message to you. You are born, live, and die only once. Everybody only once, so it means that all people are equal. Okay, thank you very much.
Dr. Katsumi, thank you so much for that and for sharing with us some of the best practices that you have identified in all the work that you've done at Nagaoka. I think it's really important. In the discussion, we'll circle back to some of those things and maybe your advice for how other universities who are interested in taking on some of those best practices can get started. But in the meantime, I would like to turn our attention to our last panelist, last but certainly not least, Dr. Don Betts. Dr. Betts is the former provost and vice president for academic affairs and professor of political science at the University of Central Oklahoma. Dr. Betts previously worked at the UN as a political liaison officer focusing on the question of Palestine, and he has also chaired the UN-sponsored international NGO meetings on the question of Palestine. Dr. Betts, you have the floor.
Thank you. Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Thank you very much. I so appreciate the introduction, and hello and welcome to all of the panelists and those that have joined the group. I'm very honored to be part of this United Nations Academic Impact Celebration of the UN at 75. I think the motto that you've selected, Shaping the Future Together, couldn't be more appropriate. And for me, it's a personal pleasure to be connected here on this panel. I would mention that part of my work at the UN back in the 1980s introduced me very early to the power of women in leadership positions, as I worked directly for the first woman Under Secretary General, Mrs. Lucille Mayer of Jamaica. And I learned a great deal from her and have consistently drawn upon the acumen that she had provided me along the way. And I've also been very encouraged by the persistence through the Millennium Development Goals and the Sustainable Development Goals of the role of women, gender, and equality showing up as it does in the SDGs as number 5. So I'm excited and I'm pleased to be here. My colleague and friend Fernando Leon had spoken earlier. We have similar experiences being university presidents and involved in higher education for a long time, and all of his comments were exceedingly relevant and also reduced my notes by at least one half. So I appreciate your comments very much, Fernando. But when we talk about gender equity, particularly in higher education, which is my vantage point today, we're looking at three groups. We're looking at students, faculty, and importantly, leadership. And on the surface, it looks as if we have attained that gender equity among students because, as Fernando has mentioned, we now have more women than men, particularly in the United States, seeking and completing baccalaureate degrees. However, if you drill down and disaggregate the data, what you begin to see is some disparities by discipline. So we still have a ways to go. For example, women are less likely to seek degrees in the important STEM fields. And we've been addressing that very directly at my former institution, University of Central Oklahoma, in a moment. If you look at the faculty ranks, you see that women are highly represented, but particularly at the lower ranks and the non-tenured track positions. And again, combination of intentionality and time hopefully will address this in the appropriate way. Women continue to be underrepresented, as Fernando has mentioned, in higher education leadership. Though the data gets better with each year, at this point, as Fernando had mentioned, about 30% of the presidencies at American colleges and universities are held by women, one of which is at my former institution, the University of Central Oklahoma that I just left, where the first woman was selected as president for the first time in 130 years. So when I think about the importance of the work that we are about, the importance of intentionally developing leadership among women, I am drawn to a couple of programs and a couple of outcomes that I have seen over these 50 years in higher education. One of them that gives me great satisfaction, though it's continuing to grow and develop, is the UCO Women's Research Center and the UCO LGBTQ plus Student Center at the University of Central Oklahoma, designed specifically and intentionally by women and as part of the academic landscape at UCO at this particular point. It's become a high impact practice through research and service learning and has engaged large numbers of women across the spectrum of the institution. Our students, approximately 65%, which happen to be women, come from what we would call the grassroots of America. These are students whose parents and families probably had not attended college in the past. In fact, the most recent entering class, 42% of those students were first generation. and the majority of them were women. But the center is focusing on research, study, scholarly, and creative activity that programs and supports women's social, economic, and intellectual development. Every year they hold an international gender and sexual studies conference, and I'm very proud of the work that they've accomplished. One of the students at the close of the last conference said, "This center gives me an opportunity to feel confident and unafraid to fight gender roles, sexual stigmas, and racial inequalities." I believe that the center epitomizes, or at least represents, an intention. And that's the point I'd like to make today. I believe there is no change that can occur if we just converse, though conversations are absolutely essential in formulating ideas and sharing perspectives. We have to move from that point into action that is well thought out, well developed, and well intentioned. But we cannot make it, if I use the term, the flavor of the day. This has to be a long-term, sustained commitment toward meaningful change. And we have to lay out opportunities for women in roles and responsibilities to lead that meaningful change. Now, many of us that serve in these leadership roles now are not women. And I believe that we have a unique historical opening to make a difference. So I think back across these 50 years of higher education, and this is what I remember. I remember creating a university campus composed of all women. I remember with my colleagues, women and men, focusing on leadership development from executive leadership programs to sponsoring women's involvement in leadership programs in the community, in the state, and in the country. I remember very well moving women into positions of academic responsibility, as Fernando had mentioned, to where now majority of the department chairs and the colleges, deans, happen to be female. The presidents of the last four faculty senates have been female. And they bring together a tradition now, an expectation among women who join the faculty and the staff, that they not only have opportunity at the institution, but they have responsibilities at the institution. Responsibilities to fully develop their leadership qualities and their leadership possibilities, and then to use them in an appropriate way to open doors for other women who are younger or less experienced or coming into the system. As is mentioned in my brief bio online, I am currently serving with ASCU, the American Association of State Colleges and Universities, an association of 380 universities across the country that educate a large number of women. And I will just close with this notion that that perception and that reality of strong, effective women's leadership is personified at ASCU, where its president, its vice presidents, and its directors are all females, drawing from a broad spectrum of women's groups across the United States. So after 50 years of grassroots work in higher education, I am encouraged, but I know that the work, has been said so often, continues. And I appreciate this opportunity to offer a few comments. Thank you very much.
Dr. Betts, thank you so much for that. And I think this is something that we really try to emphasize here at Academic Impact, that discussions are incredibly important, the sharing of information, but how do you then move to action? How do you move to implementation? So as you said, it's incredibly important to, you know, to have these discussions, to have these conversations, but then you have to move to implementation to really sort of make lasting, sustainable change. So thank you so much for that. Several things that you mentioned that I'm sure we'll get to in the discussion. I'd now like to take the time that we have to open the floor for some questions. We already have a couple of questions that you all have submitted. I'd like to open up with the executive director of UN Women, Undersecretary General You mentioned the need to build back better after COVID to ensure that we leave no child behind in education, that we have a more inclusive system that provides access to all. What sort of things should we be considering if we're to use COVID as an opportunity to address the inclusion and empowerment of women and girls in education? Are there any things that you can, you know, a few things that you could point to that we should think about? And we also had a question from someone asking about how do we take into consideration things like sexual and gender-based violence, and how do we make sure that people in the LGBTQ community are taken on board when we think about these issues?
Thank you very much. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Building back better and addressing gender inequality, I would say through technology, for instance, means that governments have to consider the access to technology as means of learning, something that should be a public good, universally accessible, and for that matter, a human right, because it is an exacerbator of inequality in society, an exacerbator of inequality between men and women, because already women and men, I mean, men already are much more connected and have access to use of digital services than women. So building back better, we can close the gap. Close the gap within societies, but close the gap also for gender. And invest in the same way that we'd invest in water and sanitation in countries when we have poor policies. This too is a major source of inequality in developing countries and anywhere in the world where it still exists.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Executive Director. Do you have any thoughts? We had a question from Renu, who was asking about sort of, you know, some of these other intersecting issues like sexual and gender-based violence that may prevent women and girls from, you know, attaining their education. And how do we also make sure we're inclusive of the LGBT community when we're thinking about these kinds of solutions and approaches?
You know, it's really important that we include as much of civil society in the policy-making spaces who are likely to stand and to fight for these rights. We know in the world that we still have many parts of the country, of many countries in the world where these rights are being denied. So we do need the rights advocates. You cannot leave this just on the hands of governments and parliaments, because sometimes these are the places where these rights are being taken. So this is a civic duty, where most of us need to fight for these rights. And for the women's movement, it's important that we take all of these rights together, because feminism means that you stand not just for your rights as a woman, but also for the rights of everyone whose needs are being denied. So you cannot be a feminist and be homophobic, a feminist and be racist, a feminist and have no attention to people who have disabilities. You have to tackle these things together. We cannot fragment these issues, because if you talk about women, some women have all of these disadvantages in one person. So it's important to take them together in policy and in practice.
Thank you. Thank you, Undersecretary General. That is so such a great call to action, that if you are for the rights of, you know, if you are a feminist, then you are for the rights of women and the rights of everyone, because women encompass all of those things. Women are faced with all of those challenges. And so really it is, you know, the fight is to fight for the rights of everyone. As they say, a rising tide lifts all ships. Thank you so much for that. I'd like to turn to Dr. Leon, because you know you spoke very forcefully about the need to create the pipeline that women's leadership and senior positions, that you have to have them, or they're more successful when they've held interim positions, when they've had advanced degrees, leadership developments, and you have to be very intentional about this. Can you tell us a little bit about, in your studies and the work that you've done, what impact this has on students on campus and student educational attainment when they see women in these positions as deans, as leaders, as educators? Why is it important that we build out equity in that way?
Well, I think, can you hear me? Okay. So I think that first of all, you know, if we're serious about this, we need to be focused, purposeful, deliberate, and we need to model. And I think the model part is very important, because to the extent that we not only talk what we consider important, but that we act, then those who will follow, the students at the colleges and universities, will see that that is important, that there is hope, and that there is a path. So, for example, I'll refer to one of the things that was mentioned earlier. I agree, well, there might seem to be progress, but if you scratch beyond the surface, you might see differences across disciplines. Unless we do something about it, nothing will happen. And I'll just mention, there's an initiative by a colleague in San Diego, Olivia Graeme. She's a binational, you know, scholar. She moves back and forth both sides of the border. She's in engineering. And of course, one of the shortcomings or shortfalls is women in engineering. So she established a program that tries to identify promising young women, girls, you know, from high school and from prepa on the Mexican side. And there's a summer program that is offered in San Diego, UCSD. But it involves both sides of the border. It began with less than 20 students. It has over 100 before COVID. It was hitting around 100. And that has been a way of identifying those who have the potential, try to espouse and develop awareness of what they could do. And then hopefully, it doesn't matter whether they go to UCSD, they might go to CETIS or some other university, they'll pursue engineering. So I think, you know, it is important to model, but also to establish specific activities that will promote that. Another thing is simply for institutions that have a scholarship program. If you have scholarships, that will try to detect or identify that talent and try to favor that talent, then you are inching forward in terms of being deliberate about these arenas. So that was regarding discipline. But I think, you know, regarding just in general, my experiences in 3-4 different institutions has been that to the extent that you are able to identify, work with, support, promote, and then continue supporting as they have achieved senior echelon positions, that will move forward. You have to be purposeful. You have to be focused. So I think that my experience has been that if you pay attention and support it, it will happen and others will follow. It is very important that as leaders, we do that. We must lead by example.
Thank you so much, Dr. Leon Garcia. That is, you know, the need to be intentional, the need to really, you know, take action and to model best practices is really important. We're coming up on time, but we have a few more questions. So if folks will want to stay on the line and if our guests can stay, because I do have a question in the chat for Dr. Ase Lumumba. Someone wants to know,
COVID has been an unprecedented event and has disrupted education, in particularly, you know, the gendered aspects of it. But do you see any differences between, are there different issues maybe for women in the global South and the global North in terms of how COVID has impacted education? Are there any different nuances that we've seen in that impact?
Thank you. Well, it is too soon to have statistics that show clear patterns. However, based on what we know, there are similarities and differences. In another talk I gave recently, I mentioned the fact that the situation of African Americans in the United States reminds me of the situation in Africa. When they say the schools are closed and you go home, what is the meaning of home? The school, the space for learning for many of these people from low-income families, African American communities here particularly, the school site offers more than learning how to read and write at the lower level. It offers food, it offers all other support system that they do not have in their communities. Similarly in Africa, when they said that the schools were closed, well, many, some of the studies I did earlier was on the experiences of girls in urban areas, girls who come from rural areas where there are no secondary schools. So when they pass their exam to go to secondary school, they have to go to the towns and cities. Well, for many of them, of students in those situations, when the schools were closed, it means they had to go back to their homes, to the rural areas that are not equipped with all the facilities. And therefore, you see the gap in access to the technology that is exacerbated in this particular context. So you see social class inequality that is reflected in the lost learning opportunities in this context of the COVID-19. So we see those pattern of social disparity and how it impacts more adversely some groups. So it is similar in the global South and also in even a country like the United States. So this is why it becomes important to close all those gaps. The other thing I want to say as time will be gone soon is that you cannot achieve gender equality in education if you don't address gender equality in all the other sectors. I did a study in Rwanda. Whatever your ideas and position about the political system in place, I learned so much in terms of the necessity to address gender issues, not only in the school system, in admitting students, female students. But what happens? Why is that they cannot pass their exam? It's not because there are genetic issues in terms of their capacities. It's because of the social system that prevent them from achieving at the same level. Therefore, what can you put in place as a policy in order to give them the same opportunity to learn, to close those gaps? And if there are issues of discrimination in the other areas of society, then access to education will not be achieved because of the necessary connection between the different sectors of society, the necessary connection between the different types of institutions. For instance, you can proclaim your commitment for gender equality. If in terms of budget allocation, the Ministry of Economy and Finance, if there's no consistency between those two sectors, then the commitment for gender equality would be a wonderful proclamation without any possibility of allocating resources where they are needed. So these are some of the points I wanted to add in terms of the necessity to think of society structurally as a whole. And this is the only way we can achieve gender equality in education. Here in the United States, for instance, and in the Western Hemisphere, among the Black communities, the situation I mentioned earlier in Lesotho is reproduced. The majority of the students are female. And yet when you see the occupation ladder, the position of leadership, you don't see that reproduction of their achievement. The Africana studies where I am here, more than 70% of the students we educate are female. And yet 50 years after this, the unit was created, they have not had one single female leader in her own right. So these are some of the issues that you find in the Global South, you find also here in the economically so-called advanced societies with all the inequalities that are embedded in.
Thank you so much, Dr. Asiah Lumumba. And I think your point is so well taken that it's really, it's, you know, not necessarily North and South, but looking at disadvantaged and marginalized communities, because you can find that all over the world. If the community is disadvantaged and marginalized, that's just going to be recreated. And the point that you were making about schools provide so much more. Women cannot return to work without children being able to go to school and having childcare. So what does that mean for women in the working world? They provide food, sometimes healthcare. You know, many of the meals that children get, you know, are served at school. So really, you know, what are the knock-on impacts of having children out of school and the double duty that that requires, mostly of mothers or of women, to now be the teacher at home, to do all the chores, the housework, prepare the meals. And so looking at that overall structural issue and how we support women is incredibly important, and I think has been brought out by COVID. Some of these things that we already knew have become much starker because of the pandemic. I would like to turn to Dr. Matsumi, because you talked very concretely about some of the things that Nagaoka has done in terms of all the activities around the Sustainable Development Goals and mainstreaming that into the work and the curriculum of the university. And I'm just wondering, for folks who are interested in implementing that at their schools, if you could talk briefly about how mainstreaming the SDGs, SDG 9, as you're the hub of, can help advance gender equality and empowerment in higher education. Sorry, Doctor, you're on mute. Unfortunately, I still can't hear you. Dr. Katsumi, while you troubleshoot that, I'm going to turn to Dr. Betts with a question for him. You know, we've talked a lot about having the intentionality of, you know, really promoting women. And so, you know, Dr. Betts, what are there ways to address these disparities in the pipeline before women get to college? Because as you said, you have to have advanced degrees. If you want these women to make it to leadership, at what level should we really start focusing on this? Is it too late once people get to college? Should we start looking at this earlier in the pipeline?
Thank you. Thank you so much, Lanice. And I've been a big advocate of leadership development that starts actually in primary school for a long time. And that's because you begin to develop your sense of self quite early, and your horizons begin to be shaped earlier than most parents imagine. I have found at the university level that we attempt to identify over many, many years, identify young, bright, talent as early as possible. So there might be a entering assistant professor of biology, and she is an outstanding candidate for leadership development by her aptitude and attitude, her ambition and her sense of responsibility. And we don't wait for her to become an associate professor or a full professor. We work with her early on. Sometimes you make the investment and it turns out to have been well positioned, and other times it doesn't work out. But the majority of the time, I have found that people respond to the intentionality of how you're proceeding. They understand that you're giving them a chance to redirect their energy and to harness their energy in a different way, because we start from the premise this is all about servant leadership. This is not about them. This is about the role they're going to play in the lives of other people. So the fullest development of their talents and their awareness is going to create opportunities for those that she and he do not know yet. That culture, which is basically what it gets down to, creating that culture of learning and leading and serving over time can, and I've seen it, can in fact imbue an entire institution to act in a certain way and to think in a certain way, sometimes not even consciously, because it's now, if I use the term, in the groundwater. But that takes a long time. But you're right, Lanise, it starts as early as possible. When he or she begins to show any interest or aptitude that looks like an opportunity for a future leader to emerge, I wouldn't squander the moment. I would move right ahead. And there, that really creates a different level and a different kind of responsibility and imperative for those of us that have the privilege of serving in leadership positions. You move into that position, but then from that point, you've got to create, as has been said several times here, not just the technical pipeline, but the psychic pipeline to leadership development.
Dr. Betts, thank you. That is so, I mean, what you said is so incredibly important, and essentially in investing in children and, you know, inculcating, ingraining this idea of servant leadership, of, you know, global citizenship. And I would argue that that would be helpful for children moving forward in any career that they choose, not just maybe in higher education and university leadership, but inculcating this so that if they become, you know, business leaders, if they become financiers, engineers, doctors, this idea of servant leadership to be ingrained in them from a very early age, like global citizenship, would be incredibly helpful for leaders of tomorrow, no matter what field they decide to pursue. I wanted to circle back to Dr. Katumi just to see if she was able to rejoin us and let her have the last word on mainstreaming sustainable development goals in your university, and then we will wrap up. Hi there, doctor.
I'm so sorry. I don't know why suddenly. Okay. My university is not focused on only SDG 9, also SDG 5, every all goal. And then because the our university is engineering, and then the almost, I think, 10% is the women. So how to try to get the student from high school is so we provide a good opportunity. And then our professors go to the COSEN and the other place, and then introduce the how engineering is so wonderful. So like we have to provide, we try to provide the education to the all of them. So anyway, we are not focused on only SD9, everything like that.
Thank you so much, Dr. Katsumi. And I think that that's an important thing to point out, is that the SDGs are interconnected. And so when you start to address one, you're more than likely addressing multiple or all of them and the benefit that has for students. I would like to now turn it over to the Chief of Academic Impact, Ramu Damodaran, for closing remarks. And I will also put the link to the survey in the chat box again. Ramu, over to you.
Thanks so much, Denise, and thank you all of you for joining. you know, when the idea of UN 75 was first discussed with the UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres, he said, let's not spend so much time looking back on 75 years, but looking ahead to the next 25 years, which will culminate in the UN centenary. So in a sense, having a conversation like this instead of 75 for 75, make it 100 for 75, will still be true for our aims. I'm so glad that we began with that song by Beth, the dance and the drum, because it was poignant in many senses. 2 days ago on Wednesday, we commemorated the death of a historical queen in India. Her name was Mumtaz Mahal, and she died in, I think, 1631 in childbirth. And her grief-stricken husband, Emperor Shah Jahan, built the Taj Mahal for her. So this idea of Beth's song, the idea of the unborn child yearning to be born, is something which I think really epitomizes much of the rethinking of gender that we need to do. And on that day, actually, I spoke to a good friend of mine who's with us, I believe, in the conversation, Dr. Padmini Murthy of the American Medical Women's Association. And she told me that an estimated 800 women die each day in childbirth or pregnancy-related complications. And if you look at that, that's really one woman every 1 or 2 minutes dying. So in the course of our conversation today, we probably lost about 80 women. That also, I think, brought in the very important theme linked through all your presentations, which is relevant to the academic impact, education. As the executive director, Dr. Fumzele Mlamgwinka, said, education cannot be taken away from you. Once you acquire education, it is yours to use, to profit by, to commercialize, and to lead your life by. Fernando Leon Garcia, the president of CITES, brought in the interesting aspect, which we touched upon later in the conversation as well, about leadership positions. But I also reflected on CITES's role as the academic impact hub for intercultural dialogue, because much of the hesitation or reticence or unwillingness to rethink gender could well be cultural. And when he came up with those instances of societies like Venezuela, like Panama, which in a formal sense might be considered traditional or rooted in customs, but the fact that they have such a large percentage and representation of women is an augury that intercultural dialogue and persuasion is beginning to change. I was also grateful for Dr. Asiye Lumumba's very pertinent comments and particularly her reference, and this was reflected later, I think, by Don Betts as well, about how difficult it is to find interest in funding women in the STEM field. The idea being that women might be good students of the humanities or of the arts, but when it comes to what are considered to be robust or muscular disciplines, you need a man, and how that needs to change. The idea of hearing and listening. Dr. Katsumi spoke again about proper education being essential to the gender gap. And I was very moved by her concluding remark, which again brings us back to the beginning of the program. You're only born once, you only live once, and you only die once. And you must give each of those three punctuation points in your life the right to flourish and be remembered by. And I think that's really the heart of what led on to Don Betts. Don has been president of two major universities, the University of Central Oklahoma and Northeastern State University. And he brought in the importance, and I suspect this also goes back to his time as a United Nations professional, the idea of the importance of conversation, the idea that one must be well-intentioned, because without good intentions or objectives, you cannot really realize that change. And I think nowhere could it be said better. Don completed his tenure as president of the University of Central Oklahoma just over a year ago. And I think he was instrumental in having as a successor, the wonderful Patty Newhold, the first woman to be head of a 4-year university program in a president of a university, four-year university program in Oklahoma, and the first president, a woman president of UCO. So he has really laid the foundation for what he believes in. So it's been a wonderful conversation, and I think we are at the United Nations at a very opportune time in many ways. For the first time in our 75-year history, thanks to Antonio Guterres, we have not only a balance, but a slight edge in senior leadership positions in this organization between women and men. And the fact that more and more women are taking on roles, including that of force commanders in our peacekeeping missions or managing humanitarian operations, goes back, I think, to the point that Dr. Asiye Lumumba was saying, that these are, in a UN sense, the STEM disciplines where women are being chosen and are proving themselves exceptionally good at, and having a playing field which is not only level, but fair, and where goals can be struck irrespective of what you were born as. And that really goes back to the one phrase in the UN Charter, which I think moves us the most, the dignity and worth of the human person. And as long as we accept that, we can constructively rethink gender. My thanks to Denise, to Omar, to Bo, to Brenda, to Dari and Telitha, our wonderful academic impact group, and to all of you for joining us. Please keep in touch with our website, academicimpact.un.org, for more of these webinars. And back to you, Denise.
Great. Thanks, everyone, so much. Please do get a chance to take the survey if you haven't. And we will also be sharing a follow-up email with you with some resources. I know some people asked about Dr. Asiye Lumumba's writing and her books, how they can get involved with any research that's happening, where they can find more information on UN Women. So thank you so much to all of our distinguished guests and panelists, and to all of our participants for being with us today in such a robust and invigorating conversation. And have a lovely weekend. And thank you to Dr. Katsumi for staying up so late into her weekend from Japan with us. Thank you, everyone. Have a good weekend. Okay. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Goodbye. Okay. Bye-bye. Good night.
Bye-bye. Thanks, everyone. Good night. Thank you, Dr. Katsumi. Good night.
Good night.